Computing webinar. The plan is to record these on a regular basis. I've been teaching computing for about 4 years or so. Been teaching the GCSE since September 2011. Can you hear me? Please, I hope you can hear me. Type something into the chat. And that's great. That's a relief. So down to business. So like yourself, I'm a computing teacher. 3 or 4 years ago, I decided I was going to have to teach computing. I didn't really have a clue. And I've tried to figure out what to do. So I made lots of mistakes. A few things have worked really well. And what I'm trying to do is to try and cut out the rubbish and give you the good stuff. So how is this possible? How am I able to do so many free things in the evening? Well, thankfully, the DfE have dug deep in their pockets, and so have the Raspberry Pi Foundation, RM Computers, well, RM Education, and a few others. And they've helped me launch a new project called Jam Packed. And the plan is that starting next month, I'm going on an 18-month roadshow to go around various parts of the UK, mostly the Midlands and north up to the Scottish borders, the East Coast and West Coast, and we're trying to bring things like Hack to the Future, Raspberry Jam, and Hack Jams all over. If we can get to a school near you, that will be terrific, or if you can come to a school near us, that will be even better. And as part of that, what I'm trying to do is make lots of resources and ideas and all sorts of things available for you. So what's the stuff? So tonight I've got a few things planned for you. So this document is like your guide to the kind of things that I'm using and sharing. And the plan is now, if you add on about half an hour or so to these, I've tried a few different things this week. Some things were a bit of a risk and some experiments. I'm going to tell you a little bit about those. I'm going to add something else in. Minecraft, ELD, and racial injustice. So yeah, there is a way of linking all those things together, if you can spell them. And then I teach two classes, GCSE computing. I have my year 11 class and my year 10 class. They're both very different. I've just recently been measuring and assessing their progress and writing reports about that. And put a smiley face in the chat if you can still hear me, or just type something in like a smile or a wink or something. So I'm going to share with you, I've brought some exercise books along, and I'm going to explain about what I've been doing with those and why are we using books? You know, we've got all this newfangled technology that always works amazingly well. Why am I using exercise books? So I'll go into that in a little while, because the rest of the world are. Okay. And then the plan is the last 15 minutes or so of tonight's session, I've got three questions, one from Les, one from Stuart, one from James. And they want to know, they're trying to challenge me in a few different things. And then the next one is on October the 22nd. That's great. Now, let's talk about what I've been doing with my classes this week. So, I don't know why, but I constantly am revising and reviewing the things that I'm doing with my classes. I'm the principal teacher of computing at our school, which means I lead a team of teachers who are delivering computing here to our ladies in Preston. And, well, we had a curriculum plan about 3 years ago that was to do lots and lots of coding and programming and things with Scratch and Python. And then last year we came up with a new plan, which was to have lots of exciting and amazing things happen all the time. And then, I don't know, I just got to the summer and I have a colleague called Joe who teaches with me, and we looked at it and it just seemed very, very busy. And as we were trying to fit all of these things in, I started to think, wouldn't it be better actually if we did less stuff but did more quality and focused on the good things? So we're actually now teaching GCSE computing to year 7, to year 8, and to year 9. My year 11s that did their exam this year in the summer, when they were in year 10, some of them started saying to me a little bit like an angry customer, hang on, this is not what we thought GCSE computing was. We thought it was all about games and Xboxes and all that kind of stuff. And maybe I cajoled them a little bit into doing computing, but they hadn't really had any experiences in year 7 or year 8 that was going to inform their judgment. So Joe and I sat down and we talked about what are we going to do in September 2014. So we looked at the GCSE computing and thought, what if we started teaching it in year 7 and year 8 and year 9? Would they get a better, more informed experience of what they would be doing at GCSE. So that's what we're doing. So we're only actually doing one topic a term. And the way that works, and what I'll do is I'll put a link in a little bit, is in the autumn term, we're learning all about what you might call A451. So in our lessons at the moment, year 7, year 8, and year 9, they're all actually studying A451. But they're just not quite studying at the same level and depth that a GCSE class might do. So my year 10s and my year 11s are also studying A451. That's all the theoretical aspects. Things like, what's a computer anyway? What's computing? What's computer science? Do computers have inputs and outputs? What do they look like? Are they keyboards and mice? Binary? Hexadecimal? Deanery? All those kind of things. And that's what our year 7s, year 8s, and year 9s. So I'm having to change the way I've been teaching for the last few years because we're teaching a lot of lessons where I'm thinking, gosh, we've not actually used the computers today, and we're doing a lot of theory and we're learning as we go along. So some of the things, I've brought some exercise books along at the moment because that's the thing I said I was going to talk about. So I was reading some of the forum posts on the Computing at School forum yesterday. I love the Computing at School forum. I wish I had more time in the day to go on there and read and answer questions. But one of the discussions was, how are people demonstrating progress? And also, I noticed on the Facebook page, this happened quite a lot. So some people are saying that they're using blogs and wikis. Now, we tried that about a few years ago, but the problem we had was the rest of the school weren't. And children were coming in to class. I say, right, open up your blog, open your wiki, write in, what have you learned today? What have you done today? This sort of thing. And then somebody might come into my lesson to observe what I'm doing, and they'd say to the children, so what have you been learning? And where's your exercise book? And the children didn't have exercise books, so our colleagues were coming in, and they kind of expected that children were going to have an exercise book, and they could open the exercise book, and they could look at examples of nice, beautiful handwriting and assessment and progress. And it was quite difficult for the children just to go, oh, do you know what? In computing, we actually use technology to record and document what we're doing. So we actually came out really badly in our book scrutinies and monitoring because it wasn't very easy for other people to evaluate what we were doing. And as well as that, the children didn't really get or understand because they come into our computing lessons and they might have 1 hour a week and we're saying, here, learn, 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 learn. Now, type up this thing. And it just seemed very different to what they were doing in other subjects. So it was a bit like, the cliche of King Canute trying to sail against the tide. By the way, are you still awake? If you are, just type in a little message in the chat so I know that you are still there. That's good. Okay, great. So you're still with me. So about 2 years ago, we reverted back to using exercise books. So our exercise books now, this is Key Stage 3, Year 7, Year 8, and Year 9, they look a little bit like this. And I'm just covering up Michelle's name so you can't read her name. Oh, there I go, I've said it. And so our exercise books look like you'd see exercise books in other curriculum areas. Now, this girl, Michelle, she's in year 7, and what she's done is she has on the front of her book a literacy label. Now, you may have them in your school. Our school go wild about these. So every exercise book, they have their literacy targets written on the front. So in their English lesson, they did a test. And the results of that test said, oh, Michelle, you always confuse homophones, words that sound the same and you spell them incorrectly. So she would have written that down as a literacy target. So we have to make reference back to these. So year 7, they only get one lesson a week, which is an hour in our school. So the school policy is within every 6 lessons, they should have one piece of formal written assessment and get feedback on that. So our exercise books, they just look like any other regular exercise books. We use the front of the books for formal written assessments, and then we use the back of the books for doing like rough work and things that don't get marked. So Mairéad, Michelle, whatever her name is, she has had 5 lessons so far in computing. And we actually, in the first 2 weeks, across all of the year groups, we actually choose e-safety as the theme. So that helps us get reacquainted with our classes, and we have a different theme with e-safety. So in year 7, we focus on grooming. In year 8, it's cyberbullying. Year 9, it's sexting. and year 10 and year 11, it's all about their digital footprint. So the way this worked was in our third lesson that we had, or our fourth lesson, Mairéad had to answer, excuse me, some questions about e-safety. Now, these questions are written down in our document. So if I type in a URL here to one of our documents, you can see that every one of my classes have their own, what do they have? They have their own document, which has my lesson notes and homeworks and all those kind of things in. I'm just going to open one of them. So they have to, sometimes they have to come up with a silly name that will help me remember, or help them remember the document. So this one's called Cow's Parp, and I'm looking for some questions. So do you know what I did? The questions, I actually read them out in class because I did different questions with each class and I didn't have enough time to type them all in. But anyway, here, year sevens in that class thought it would be funny if we had a URL called Cow's Parp, because I said we can't really put cow's fart down in a document. We can't write that in our planners, because what would people say if we write down the word fart? So we can talk about it, we just can't mention it. So there's the URL to that document, although it's a bit light at the moment on detail, but that's an example of what we're doing with my classes. So the kind of questions were things like, what are the great things about being online? You know, when I was 11 in 1983, we didn't have internet and things like that. But now we do have, what can you do with it? So what were all the great things? Second question was, describe some of the nasty things that can happen when you're online. Question number three, we watched a video, a SEOP film, where there's a story, like the Think You Know type films. Describe what happened in that story. And then in that story, I don't know if you've seen, it's the one with Justin and Jade, and he gets her to, he kind of blackmails Jade into taking some pictures that were of a risky nature, or revealing photographs. How was it that Justin managed to get Jade to do this? So they have to explain that. Now, these books, we did this last week on Thursday, Wednesday with year seven, and I've not actually assessed those ones yet, but when I do mark them, they'll have some green writing because we use green pens to assess them, and they'll have lots of literacy comments. So if Jade is spelt with a small J, if she's spelt friend wrong, or if she's spelled here, HEAR. Oh, there we go, Michelle. That's a homophone. It's a word that sounds the same as something else, but you've actually misspelled it. And we'll give Jade, Michelle, an action point, which could be something like, list two or three other positive things. Or your friend tells you that they're being cyberbullied. What advice would you give them? So they have an action, and then in lesson, they get their books back, and they have to respond to the action, correct the literacy issues, and then we put the books away. And we carry on with the things we're doing in class. Now, I think I've got about another 10 minutes or so to tell you some of the other things that have been happening with Key Stage 3. So, in terms of measuring and assessing progress, well, there's big emphasis on literacy. I mean, we even get children now to do a sample of their handwriting in the front of their book, and for this, they have to provide a sample of their best quality handwriting, so that we can then say later on, the idea is we're supposed to give them books back to them and say, sorry, Michelle, you're gonna have to do it all over again because that's not your best quality handwriting. I've not actually had to do that yet, but maybe just the exercise in writing that out. So this is a school-wide policy and practice that it's one of those things that when you say to children, literacy labels, that's all you have to say. They know exactly what they have to do. So it does make life easier when everybody's doing things together. I think my buttons keep banging on the table. Just take my jacket off. Now, something just a little bit more interesting and different from exercise books. So our school has these, they're called extended learning days. They're called ELDs, and I'm going to highlight one here, just the letter ELD. So what actually happens on an ELD is all of the school, their normal timetable is suspended for the day. And they get to follow different themes in different areas. So on Thursday, me and my colleagues, a group of us, were working with year eight for the day, and our theme was racial injustice. So in drama, they they discussed it, the issues around racial injustice, and they described and designed and scripted a performance, and then later at the end of the day, they all acted out their performance in art and music, and what else was another subject? So it art and music, they responded as well to racial injustice to figure out why do people do these kind of things. What did we do in computing? Well, I hope it wasn't too tenuous, but I really, really wanted to use my Raspberry Pis with my Year 8s all day long, because to get the Raspberry Pis out of the boxes and plug them in and switch them on and do stuff with them, you need more than an hour, really. And Year 8, they get an hour 1 week and 2 hours the next week. But even then, we have computer rooms set up with desktop PCs. And if you think, right, let's use the Raspberry Pis today. So I get the boxes out, plug them in. Oh, yours is not lighting up. Have you? Oh, yeah, you're plugged into the wrong port. So I thought, right, we've got 5 hours with one class. Let's see if we can use the Raspberry Pi. Now, I'm going to pause. Can you still hear me? If you can, just type something into the chat, like a smiley face or something. I know you're still paying attention. Great. Thank you. So, Raspberry Pi, racial injustice. So, you know what we did? I planned for a few different activities where we were trying to help children understand racial injustice and then find some kind of response. So, the way it worked was, start of the day, we actually started watching a clip I found on YouTube, which is the Rosa Parks. She gets on the bus driver asks her to move, and this kind of thing. And I paused the video partway through when she sat down, and who knows what happens next. We had a little bit of discussion, and why did this happen, and how long ago was this, and why, are we still like this? Has society moved on? So we had a let's set the tone. Now, the next thing I said, I've brought in some Raspberry Pis today. Now, there was 24 children in the group. Who's ever heard of a Raspberry Pi? Got one, done anything? Just one child in the class, and their uncle. No, the brother had a Raspberry Pi and had shown them what the things to do, but the rest of the class didn't really know what I was talking about. So I explained about a little bit about what the Raspberry Pi is. Hey, let's get them out. These Raspberry Pis have got Minecraft, so let's plug them in and let's see what we can build in Minecraft. Let's go and build some amazing thing. So got out all the bits accessories that we're going to need and a little bit of direction. Let's go for it. So 20 minutes later, everybody's got their Raspberry Pis plugged in, using as much of the desktop equipment as we can. So power supplies from the desktop computers. We're plugging into the screens that are already there in the room. And within 20 minutes or so, everybody's in Minecraft. So, okay, ready, pause. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and all the screens off. Now, everybody in Year 8 at this point, you use Scratch, you learned how to use it in Year 7, you built some games. We've all got a racing car game in Scratch on our Raspberry Pi. It might be called Marble Racer, or you might have. So what we did was we took the Marble Racer game within Scratch, and we actually we forked it. We changed a version where we said, what if Scratch was actually prejudiced or racially unjust? And what if at the beginning of the game you got to choose a black marble or a white marble? Maybe what we could do is we could actually have a black marble that just never seems to get fast enough. And when you get to the corners, it's a bit too slow and the timer runs out fast. So we actually built a parody. And as the children actually got into this a little bit more than I thought they would. They were trying to figure out how much stuff could they do to stack things up against the black car, the black marble, and the white one. And we were talking about, how prejudice, manifests itself in different ways. So that we spent about an hour looking at this, and I did keep explaining, this is a parody. We're talking about how, what different ways can racial prejudice manifest itself. Then we paused after that and I said, right, we might come back to this later on. So if when they were in Year 7, some of them had me for computing, some of them had some different teachers, and we used Python to build a text-based chatbot. So I said, now sometimes when you have conversation with people, they look at you and they make certain judgments about you. So, like, for example, I don't have a lot of hair, so maybe people think that I might be over a certain age. Maybe if you speak with a certain accent, people may a prejudice towards you. Maybe the way that you dress, you know, if I had tattoos all over my face and rings through my noses, you might respond in a different way. How would a chatbot respond differently based on the responses? So we started with a model of a chatbot that just basically says, "Hello, what's your name?" "Alan." "Hello, Alan." But we then started to modify it and hack it so that it has some aspects of selection in there. So if, for example, it asked you, "What color is your skin?" and you said you were brown or white, it might. And I did have to keep reminding the children this. What kind of prejudices exist when we know things about people? And so that went so long, although we did have some issues there dealing with syntax that some children hadn't had any experiences of using Python at all, text-based programming. And anyway, so we go back to the. I'm reading what's going on in the chat. I love the fact that we've got this back channel going on. It's like the corridor track. People share things, whatever. You can ignore me. That's great. And people often do anyway. And then the other thing we did was let's go back to Minecraft. Now, they were working in pairs through a lot, and I didn't explain this to you that we had. I had 11 Raspberry Pis set up in the room, and we had 22 children. And for the most part, they were working in pairs. Actually, as I remember, we had an odd number. We had it was something like we had 23 children and 11 Raspberry Pis. So for the most part, they were working in pairs. Now, in every pair, I said, we're going to start off the person on the left, you're going to be the driver, and the person on the right, you're going to be the navigator. So the way driver navigator works is first 5 minutes, driver, they use the Raspberry Pi, they use the keyboard, they use the mouse, they make everything happen, but they don't do anything unless the navigator tells them what to do. So navigator's going, open Scratch, find the marble eraser, there it is, right. Make a copy of the marble, change it to white. There's a black marble, there's a. So, and then after 5 minutes, beep, 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 timer goes, and I say, right, driver navigator, now you swap over. Now, I just remembered there's a question that James has asked me. How do you differentiate with Python? So you can differentiate with Python the way you can differentiate with most things. So although in this particular activity, they had 5 minutes each, 5 minutes driving, 5 minutes navigating, sometimes in my lessons, I actually construct the pairs. So we'll have, for example, it might be that person on the left, their target grade is a B. Person on the right, their target grade is a C. Person on the left, their target grade is a D. Person on the right, their target grade is an E. I sometimes try to pair them so that they're, in terms of targets, they're just stepped slightly rather than have, you know, an A target working with an E target because that's quite a big gap in between them. And what I actually do, I'm going to set a timer equally and I'll say, right, okay, so I've got my digital timer and I set the timer up for 5 minutes. I sometimes stretch the truth slightly. I say, right, okay, so we're going to have 5 minutes and go. What I actually do sometimes is I skew the timings. So let's just say we have this person on the left who we'll call Ben, and Ben's target grade is an A star. And Ben is working with Michael, whose target grade is a B. So what I might do is I might actually have Ben only driving for 4 minutes, but when Michael come, yeah, that's right. And when Michael comes to drive, Michael drives for 6 minutes. That means that Ben's going to have to do an awful lot more. Yes, Michael. Now what we need is we need some selection. So we need to type the colon in here, and then okay, everybody, your 5 minutes is up. But you and I know it's not really 5 minutes; it's four and six. And so far, nobody's ever realized that the timing is skewed. But what, I'm just reading what Ben's typing in the chat. But one of the things that does is I'm subtly and I try not to make it like 3 minutes and 10 minutes because that really would be obvious. But so far, nobody has picked up on the little game I'm playing because they're actually usually so engaged in what's going on. They're working and supporting each other that they don't even notice the time going on. So the same Minecraft. So going back to the extended learning day, and I reckon I need to stop in the next 5 minutes on this section. So extended learning day, we've set up the Raspberry Pis. We talked a bit about Rosa Parks, the lady on the bus who had to get off, she got arrested. What would a racially prejudiced game look like in Scratch? What would a racially prejudiced chatbot look like? How can we identify racial prejudice? How can we remove it, reduce it, this kind of thing? And now we're onto Minecraft and we were driving and navigating. And I said to them, now, you've got half an hour. Now imagine you're in Minecraft and you own the Minecraft world and you can have whatever blocks you want, no matter how much they cost. And you've got half an hour to build a house and it's going to be the biggest, best house you've ever lived in. Driver navigator, show me what's the best. So they went off and we had houses that had like 20 floors and we made out of glass and diamonds and all like amazing houses. And I took pictures of all of these and let me just see while I'm talking. I wonder, can I find you pictures of their houses? Some of them looked pretty spectacular. So they were building these amazing houses for half an hour, driving, navigating, swap over driver, swap over navigating. Now you can probably start to figure out what's happening, but these amazing houses going on. Now, I then said, there's some pictures from earlier today, we're planning our next events coming up. So here are some of our pictures. So we had these fantastic looking mansions and palaces made out of gold and diamonds and plasma and all these. And then I said, oh, do you know what? Oh, we spent too much time building. Now, all these people who've been building your palace, they're like your workers and they're really tired and you've only got a few hours left. Oh, and you know what? You've used up too much of your construction funds and your resources, but you're going to have to build dwellings for these people. So, look, you've got 15 minutes left. Now, this time you can only use like three different types of blocks, and you're going to be as quickly as possible. So they built all these like little mud huts and brick huts for their workers, and then somebody started saying like, "Sir, isn't this a bit like, was it in America back in, when was it like in the 1800s and the 1850s when they had these like, so what we've got is we've got these cotton plantations." And some of them said because the little mud huts and brick huts didn't look that good, they kind of took them away around the back. And so basically we've got a prejudiced Minecraft world now where the slaves, the unworthy folks, they would have these little huts where loads of people had to live in them because they hadn't got enough time to build them. Okay, so there we go. So that was the extended learning day, pretty much, except we then had an hour where we kind of had, so folks, in an hour's time, we're going to go to the assembly hall and we're going to have people demonstrating things in drama. We're going to have music performances. We're going to have art displays. What can we show people with what we've done? So some people went back to their Scratch games, some went back to their chatbots, but on the whole, most people wanted to go back to Minecraft and they wanted to show just how bad the world can be when we start to be prejudiced. Now, what I would have liked, maybe, if I'd realized exactly how much of a draw and attraction Minecraft was going to be, we could have left out the Scratch and the Python and we could have done a little bit more coding. Hacking Minecraft with Python and the API, but on reflection, I didn't allow enough time to do that. So that's probably something we're going to try in the future. So that's a little bit of insight into what I've been doing this week. Now, back to our program for this evening. So, one of the things I was going to explain about a little bit was one aspect of teaching GCSE computing. Now, what I'm planning to do, I have a year 10 class at the moment, and I'm trying to get them ready so that in January or February, they can start doing the programming controlled assignment, what we might call A453. Now, the problem is, if we start spending all of our lessons getting them ready to understand things like data representation, different data types, strings and integers, and then writing a sequence of instructions and ability of selection. And I've been looking at the different tasks that the exam board have set, and I've got my sights set on there's one that's like you have to write a maths quiz for a teacher in a primary school, and it has to randomly give them different questions. Now, in my last computing at school meeting here in Preston, we tried to do just that very task in 40 minutes. So I put the teachers together and I did the same thing. We had drivers and navigators. We started off by analyzing the requirements for the task. I'll just put a link to that in this document because you might find that's a useful thing to look at afterwards. So some of the teachers, designed their algorithms. They designed their algorithms, and then they decoded solutions to that, and there's links to all of those in that document. So I might as well share them with you now while I'm talking about it. So I put the Kaz Preston notes, and if you ever come back to this again, you'll see that we'll update that as we go along. Okay, it's a bit too big, but there's photographs of some of the coded solutions we did to the first part of that task. Anyway, back to what I was talking about. So I'm trying to get my year 10 class ready so that they can tackle the control assessment after Christmas. What about teaching the theory? Now, I've tried lots of different slants on teaching the theoretical elements of the GCSE. And the model I've now got, this is like my fourth time round with a GCSE class. They have these orange books. And again, more exercise books. Earlier, I was talking about the blue exercise books for Key Stage 3. These are the orange homework books for my GCSE computing class. Now, what I've done is I've set my GCSE year 10s a program of 38 homeworks for the rest of the year. And each of these homeworks have supported it with a number of resources. So a couple of years ago, we bought paper copies of the Susan Robson book. Quite lucky, just in the summer term, we bought an electronic copy, and now it looks like Susan Robson's GCSE computing textbook is being released through a different publisher this time. And ooh, the price has gone up a little bit, and they've added more pictures in. But actually, if you've got the old books, they're just as good as the new ones. And anyway, so we've got the old paper books, so they've all got a copy of the paper book, and I've given them all an exercise book. Now, in the front of their exercise book, they all have a page that looks like this. And I've set this out with, here are the 38 topics for the year. So if I hold that close to the camera just for a minute and shift it a little bit like this, you can read. There's like a guide telling them what that should look like. Now, I need to share that with you if you're interested. But what it describes to them is five expectations for each of their homeworks. So they need to write the title and date in full. They need to use a minimum of words. Yeah, it's PG online. If you go on Amazon, you can actually buy a copy. I think it's £7,500 for a paper copy of the book at the moment, supply and demand. Or you can go to PG online and you can buy the new improved version with photographs, which is about four times the price of the original version that was on Lulu. Anyway. Back to don't detect any bitterness in my tone. Number three, they have to make full use of the page. Number four, we need diagrams, sketches, and notes. And then they have to highlight keywords. So there's five requirements for each of their homework. Now, for their homeworks, what I've done, I've directed them to page numbers in the Susan Robson book. I've also said to them, hey, look, we've got the BBC Bite Size resources, some very high quality resources there, and links to videos. And except the thing with the BBC Bite Size resources, it says you need to know about data representation. Well, here are 16 pages all about it. So what I've tried to do is I've tried to pin it down to the key pages that they need to look at. And then I've also linked to the Cambridge GCSE Computing Online, that they're the free resources are made available by OCR with people like Clive and Andrea and all sorts of different people talking about the things that you know what they are. So let me show you an example of what I'm talking about. So you just type in Cambridge GCSE Computing.org and you'll find all of them there. So what I've done is I've linked them to the appropriate section in there. And there's loads of videos and stuff. Now, to be honest, it takes more time for the homework if you're going to go and look at those videos because you have to watch them and listen to them and that kind of thing. But once they've done that, the next thing that they have to then do is they have to summarize what they've read or understood. So who's this? This is Joe's book. So I'm looking at Joe's book now, and Joe had done that. The very first one is What's a Computer System? But Joe summarized that topic there. He's made a couple of notes. And when I marked Joe's book, the first time, he got 3 out of 5. And then, now when I mark these homework books, I do have some other books that I have to mark as well. So to keep my marking burden down, I've just told them the only thing I'm going to do in these books is I'm going to give them a score out of 5 for each page if they've met all of those five requirements. And then the next thing I do is I then share those scores for the homework with their parents online. So some of you might be a bit queasy about sharing data online. And I've been doing this for about 3 years, and it's only just last week one of the Year 11 parents said to me, Alan, are you really sure you should be sharing all that stuff there online? And she's a head teacher at primary school. And when I explained to her what it was, it was such a, right, okay, sorry. I thought that what you were doing was you were telling me you were sharing like my child's test scores and all those kind of things online, and I'm not. So I'll just copy a link and put that into the document that I've been showing you. So, homework tracker. There's a link to that, so you can have a look at that. And this is the kind of thing that I will send. I've now got all of my parents' email addresses. Bye, Claudio. Claudio, see you again. All of my children's homework scores are now there online. I've got all of the parents' email addresses. And what I'll do is I will send an email every week or two to say, oh, by the way, I've just marked your child's homework. So some parents will go on there, like Alex's, oh, sorry, Joe's parents might go, well done, Joe. 5 out of 5 for every homework. Wow, that's great. Whereas this James, his parents might go on and say, James, what's going on? You got 3 for the first one and you got 0 for all these. So hopefully they're the kind of conversations that are going on. And what I've just started doing, and I do this with my year 11s, is I've now started inviting some of those parents to come into school if they want to talk about their child's homework progress, or could they just simply make sure that the child turns up on a Wednesday or a Thursday afternoon, and I will give their child all the support they need with their homework. And that seems to be making a big change and a big difference. I'll show you, that's a year 10 class. I'll just show you what a year 11 class looks like. Now, there's very little interaction going on between me and you at the moment. I keep reading the chat. Just type something into the chat if you want to ask me a question about what I'm doing, what I'm talking about at the moment. I'd be happy to answer any questions. But what I am going to do in a couple of minutes, I'm going to open the microphone and you can talk to me. Just get my year 11 class up. I can show you a little bit of a difference. So my year 11's very, very polarized. So I've got a class that I didn't teach in year 10. I've inherited this class from a colleague. And this is what they look like. So we've got some children who I've highlighted because, like this boy here, so far hasn't shown me a single homework, evidence of a single homework. But then we have other pupils in the class who are showing me every week that they're doing their homework. And this is great. And some of them recently, so like this boy here, he came after school on Wednesday. He did an hour on Thursday. Oh dear. Can you still hear? Homophone there. Can you still hear me? And so what happened was, Ryan is the type of child who, it's a bit of a struggle to get him to do homework. It's a bit of a struggle to get him to come in at lunchtime, a bit of a struggle to get him to come after school. But I sent a text message home to all the parents and said, please, can you send me your email address? And then I can email you some information about how your son or daughter is doing in class. So Ryan's parent didn't reply. So I got quite a few emails from parents, and I started making a list. And there's still some parents I hadn't had an email from. So, but I persisted because actually, it's the ones who never reply, kind of the way it goes, are the ones that you need to speak to the most. So I persisted. So after about 4 text messages, I think Ryan's mum gave in and sent me an email and said, here's my email address. And then she sa then said that she'd had a conversation with Ryan, and Ryan was going to come after school. And you know what? Ryan's been after school. And now Ryan said, sir, would it be okay with you every week if I came after school to do my homework? Because actually, I don't mind coming after school. So, but I've not marked Ryan's book yet, so that's why we've got that. Now, back to measuring and assessing progress. Right, I'm going to have to speed things up a little bit. So, with my year 10s and my year 11s, I now know that they've got this kind of extracurricular program going on where they are reading up on these topics. They're providing me evidence that they're doing that. So I was showing you Joe's book before. So when I scroll back through Joe's pages, I can see now that each week Joe is doing the requisite homework. What we've had to do, because homework now I've decided is going to be a really important factor in class, we've had to have one or two lessons where quality takes a dip. So we take a break from what we're doing in class, and we have a homework lesson where we actually model the homework in class, and I do a lot of intervention to help them get their homework up to the standard. The difficult boys in that year 11 class, four of them, the last three lessons, have been running a homework club actually in the lesson. So while the rest of the group are working on their programming assignment, these four boys been sat in isolation in the class just doing homework. And it started off with seven, then the next lesson it was six, and now I'm down to four, and I'm hoping eventually get down to one, and then this one tough cookie, it's sort of, a process of elimination. Eventually the message should get through. But that in itself is not really giving me an accurate measure of their understanding and awareness and their attitudes towards computing. So over the summer, I'm a bit of an early riser, I would wake up about 5 a.m. each morning, so I'd spend about an hour and a half or so, and I took a load of GCSE papers and I turned those into slightly different questions which I've put on Moodle. So I've created loads of quiz questions in our Moodle. I've got so far, I've got 180 questions or so, and they all dovetail nicely into those same topics. Now, there is a point where I want to share all these questions online, but at this point, I'm not quite ready to share all of them. If you really want to see what they look like and you send me a nice email afterwards, I'll send you a link. I think I've already linked them in the Computing at School forum as well. One of my reasons for putting them in Moodle is there is a Moodle course online that anybody can go to, teachers, and there's a point where I'm going to invite everybody to it and say, look, here, there's loads. Anyway, cut to the output. So every 2 weeks, my year 11s do a 10 to 20 question quiz, which has got questions that are like GCSE questions, but they're just focused on the topic that we've been doing in the previous couple of lessons. And I tell you what's amazing is today was the deadline for our year 11 interim progress reports. So what I did was I went on to OCR and I looked to see what was the boundaries for A451 for like an A star, an A, a B. And I got those numbers. So I put those numbers into a spreadsheet. And then what I did was I, like a lookup table, gets very geeky next. So then I have the children's target grades. So when I looked at my year 11, some of the target grades they were set last year were wildly ambitious. Some were not ambitious enough. So I reviewed their target grades. And I took those target grades and I converted them into what would be a number for the A451 that would get them their grade. And so I've now got, let's say Lucas, let's say his target grade, for example, was a B. Well, for the A451 this summer, he would have had to get 66%. So every child in the class now has a number next to them. In fact, I can show you this. Instead of telling you about it, I can show you. Where are we? Oh, here they are. Now, what I've actually done is it's hidden. So as I click down here now, you can't read what they are. But what I can do, if you don't look, I've just copied somebody's. Was it this one or this one or this one or this one? And let me paste it over here. And now if I make the ink black, that's the fail. Make the ink black on that. So there's somebody's target score. So that person, whoever it was, is a 46. So if they get a 46 in summer 2015, if they get 46%, they're going to achieve their target in the exam. Now, the next thing I did with the child I took that from was they've done two tests recently, quizzes. So let's look at Lucas. So Lucas, although he's not doing his homework, he's a lucky son of a so-and-so, because Lucas actually scored in the quiz 27% more than his target grade. So if Lucas's target grade was 50, Lucas scored 77. So I've got like a conditional format set up to show that Lucas is actually in the green, even though he never does any homework, he's in the green. Let's have a look at some other examples, because you do see correlations, like Emily, for example, who always does her homework. Well, she's on target at the moment because in quizzes in class, she's scoring round about what she should be getting as her target grade. Let's choose another one. Sebastian, who never does any homework. He's quite a bit off his target. Now, why could that be? Let's have a look at another one. Ryan, who never does any homework. His quiz scores. He's a bit off his target as well. Let's find somebody else who always does their homework. Oh, Suhail. Look at Suhail. Pretty much always does his homework, and he's on target. So there are some strong correlations. It doesn't always work as Lucas is determined to show me. So that's my next point. Now, the parent who was concerned that I was showing feedback, I discussed this with her and she thought it was a good idea. So I'm using her as my benchmark. Now, it's about time for me to stop talking about GCSE computing and go back to the agenda. So it's 9. It's 7:12, and I'm planning in the next 10 minutes to stop this. Can you just tell me, you can still hear me clearly? Is this working okay for you so far? Has it been helpful? A little bit of, yeah, that's great. Okay. So Les asked me a question earlier. Les says he's teaching. Let me take that, turn that into black. It's going to be a little easier for you to read. So I'll change the color from dark gray. So Les is teaching OCR computing first time round. Welcome to the club. And he's going to be setting the A453 this year. Now, from experience, I've learned it's a good time to start this just after Christmas. Our children go on work experience just before February half term. So I like to get started with A453 just before then. So Les wants to see some previous examples of students' work for this task. And he posted some of that in the chat before, and I saw a few people shared some things. So if you go onto the chat now and scroll back, there's a couple of examples on there that you can share. Now, I'm really hoping that there's no children on here pretending to be teachers, because if they are, and you've just given solutions to live tasks, that could cause somebody some problems. One of the things that I've done, I'm just going to go and get this from my Year 11 document, is I took the OCR specimen tasks and I carved them up because they were actually massive documents. So I carved them up into smaller chunks and I named the A star document Charlotte because girls are great at computing, aren't they? Let's debunk some of those prejudices that some people have. And boys think that they're great at computing, but not all of them are, because some of them never do their homework, and then when they do the tests. So what I've done is I've carved these up into little slices. And if I go back to the document that I'm sharing with you, so these are the OCR examples. Now I actually share these with my Year 11s all the time. So when Lucas says, "Sir, I'm really stuck on what I'm going to do for task one," I say, "Well, have you looked to see what Billy did?" So Lucas can go and have a look at what did Billy do for analysis. Now, if you've got a child whose target grade is a C, a D, an E, so on, watch out for this. They might go, "Oh yeah, so we have to make something work out dog or cat ages." No, you don't. What you're supposed to be doing is you're doing your assignment, but you can look at Billy. How did Billy do this? Now, my advice would be use these specimen tasks. And before you start the live one, use these as model assignments. Because the one thing you can do with these is if you tell your class to do task one and then you're going to mark it, you can give them as much feedback as you want. You can tell them what score they got for that. And you're not breaking any rules. The thing you're not allowed to do is you're not allowed to do that for the live assignments. So that's what we've been doing. So and there's no reason why you have to spend 2 hours doing it. You could just do it in 10 minutes. You could do this. You could say, "Right, okay, everybody, pair up." So I've done this at some of our CAS meetings. Ben was at a computing at school conference session I did. It's great. Practice it over and over again, because the thing is, again, driver navigator. Get them to practice, 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 specimen assignments, not the live ones. And then you can give them as much feedback as they want, and practice makes perfect. So that's an answer to Les's question. Now, I do have lots of examples of previous assignments, the things like the game encounter task where they have a dice, but I'm still not absolutely clear about how much of that I can share. So I'm just trying to stay within the rule at the moment till I actually get a green flag. I know they're not live assignments anymore, but if I start sharing solutions online, my children are still doing that. So I'm not going to give them solutions, otherwise it causes lots of problems. In fact, I did have, in the first year I taught this, one of my year 11 said to me, "Sir, I think that James has gone online and cheated and got an example from somebody else." I said, "Is that true?" So I'll talk to James because James is quite conscientious. "James, is this true?" "Oh, well, sir, I just found this thing online and I looked at it. I haven't copied it exactly." I've said, "James, you cannot use it. And now that you've found it, it's going to be really hard for you because you're going to have to pretend you've not seen it." And he could not. Once he'd seen it, he couldn't pretend he hadn't seen it. So I said, "James, you're now going to have to find a different way of solving the problem. You're going to have to say to people in your document, 'Here's a solution I found online. Here's my other way of solving it.'" So James had to work extra hard, and it's tough, you know. So it's really not a good idea to share solutions to live assignments. So I'm going to follow my advice. I'm not going to, even though they're not live anymore, there are still classes, schools who are doing it. Stuart, you want to know how to structure A452 assignments. That's the investigation. So what I would suggest that you do, if you listen to my podcast, if you want to follow what I'm doing with my year 10s, and a plan that every time I do one of these to update you, I don't actually do the investigation assignment until into year 11. I think what I'm going to be doing this time is I think I'm going to be doing that Linux-based one because there's quite a lot of scope there. And I had a bad experience with the Little Man computer last year, and I don't know if I just have a break from Little Man computer. I love it, but yeah, I am doing some training, Ben. That's on the, is that like a plug for another? I am actually doing a training session on the 10th of November in school. But Ben, if you reply and fill it in that form, I can do that in one of these sessions here. So I can do that on this. So you don't have to come to my school if you don't want to. And I can also do it at a CAS meeting as well. I love the Little Man computer, and I still will be using it in class. I'm just not so sure now I'm going to use it as an investigation assignment. I've got a little project I'm working on as well. I put out like a shout in Preston Online to students at UCLAM, that's our local university, and our students who did our GCSE last year and the year before, they're doing A level at our partner Sixth Form College. And I said, "Would you like to come into our school and get paid to work with our GCSE computing students to mentor them? Not to give them solutions, but to try and guide and coach them." So I'm going to be running some sessions after school on Wednesdays, Friday evenings, and some Sundays, up to Christmas. And I think I might just do give children a choice of looking at the different investigation assignments. But back to Stuart's question, there's nothing to say, Stuart, that you have to say, "Right, here's the 20 hours. Okay, class, go off. You've got 20 hours, go and do it." What you might do is get them ready for the first part, and you are expected to teach part of it, and then you have to let them go. Now, James, you ask, how do you differentiate, particularly with Python? So a couple of things I'm going to suggest. James, are you on the chat at the moment, or did you have to go off and eat something because I had problems? If you're here, James, I'm going to ask is, have you tried using Sabotage for the class? It's becoming, I know, a little bit old hat, but if you've not tried it, it's good to give it a go. So, Stuart, do you know what I think I'll do is, because I had problems setting this up tonight, I'll come back to the Little Man computer in a future podcast webinar thing. But it's something I definitely need to address. Back to James's question. So Sabotage, I'll put a link to that in a minute. But then the other one I said, the driver navigator. So that's a really good example where you pair up, and you really need like some assessment evidence to help you structure your pairs so that you can have a slightly stronger navigator working with a weaker driver and swap them around. So try those to help differentiate, and I think that may help. I'm sorry, because I had a technical issue, it's made this go on for a bit longer than it was meant to do. And I did say I was going to turn the microphone on, and I haven't done that. Let me just do that now. So I've got loads of things on my screen. I don't know what's going on. So I think if you try and talk, you should be able to. If your microphone's plugged in, you can ask, or just type something into the chat, and I'll answer your first question too that come through. Otherwise, I'm going to say goodbye, and then that'll be the end. So I'll just hang on for a moment. So if anybody's got any questions, so as there's no other questions coming through at the moment, Stuart, there is a specimen little man computer task on the OCR website that again shows how to set it up. The main thing about the documentation is it has to like tell a story. They started off, what did they do? Lots of screenshots, I know, but how did you go along? Also, understand that the vast majority of your class are never going to get into like the latter parts of the investigation assignment. It tends to most of the class will probably complete two of the tasks. There's no expectation that everybody in the class is going to manage to do all of them. Right. I'm really sorry about the technical problems. How did you comment on so the Google document? Oh, that's a question for Les. Sorry. Right. I hope you found this webinar, the first of its kind, quite helpful. I'll send a questionnaire out to you later on to ask what can I do next time. I'm not so sure why the technology let us down tonight, but thank you very much for listening. And if you're in a school in the north of England, thank you, Ben. And that's like the Midlands up to Scotland, east or west coast, and you'd like us to come to your school to do a Hack the Future, a Raspberry Jam and Hack Jams, or if you're in Hull or Salford, you can come to one of our events there for free and find out what we're doing. Thank you very much. I'm going to say goodbye and good night. And if you've not eaten something, go and eat something and let your family know that you love them. Yes, Ben, I am doing some training on Little Man computers. Oh gosh, I've already answered that question. Thank you very much and goodbye.